You mentioned that we, in what seems quaint now, the vice president shot his friend.
Yeah. It counted as a calamity.
Yeah, it was a big deal. Yeah. But is it true that you had to urge, because Vice President Cheney did not want to actually do press about it.
No.
But that was a thing that people had questions about. Because
he
shot his friend.
Yeah.
How did you convince somebody
So in the old days, Republicans would try to spend a week on a message, and the president had just given a State of the Union address, and we were trying to spend the week talking about switchgrass or some sort of renewable energy. Bush got very into that in 2005. And so we were going through the messages of the day on a Sunday afternoon, and my colleague Dan Bartlett said, "Oh, one more thing." And I said, "Oh, okay. What?" And he said, "Cheney shot somebody." And I was like, "Oh, well, is everybody okay?" And he said, "No, he's in the hospital." And I said, was it a crime scene? No, they were hunting. And I said, "Okay, well, I didn't see that. Did we put it out?" And he said, nope, Cheney doesn't want to tell anybody. I said, "Well, he's the vice president. We should tell somebody."
Yeah.
And he said, "No, maybe what's the hunting magazine like? Guns and
I don't know. I can pretend."
He wants to tell some outdoor magazine. I said, "No. I mean, he has a press corps. We have to tell the press corps." So Monday, he didn't tell anyone. Sunday, Monday came around, and our White House press secretary Scott McClellan was just pounded because now there was a stakeout at the hospital. I mean, everyone knew he shot his friend.
Probably no questions about switchgrass day.
We were not driving our energy message. We had to involve folks at the highest levels. In those days, it was viewed as a way to move past a crisis to do an interview with a friendly outlet. So we suggested an interview for him, and there was a lot of yelling and screaming, and it felt... The vice president never really forgave me for making him do an interview about shooting his friend, but ultimately, we had to involve the president.
If his friend forgave him, he should forgive you. That's the only thing I would say.
I think so.
I want to... I'm fascinated, and he really is one of my dream guests. I'm fascinated by Sean Spicer's day-to-day.
Yeah.
Watching someone... that wasn't specifically your job, but that thing of presenting the message.
Yeah.
Do you have, because again, this is a job he chose, so I don't want to say sympathy, but do you at least have a sympathy for the difficulty of that job that he is given every day to go out and without any information have to answer
questions? No one should feel sorry for anyone in the White House. Those are the best jobs on the planet. They are, you literally have a badge that lets you walk onto this magnificent 18-acre complex, and you don't just work for the guy who's elected. The public is allowed to walk through it because it is the people's house. So no one should feel sorry for anybody that works in the White House. I can empathize with what it's like to deal with a rabid press corps, but he makes them angry by telling them nothing.
Yeah.
So I think that some of his problems are of his own creation. What's interesting to me about Sean, I know Sean. Sean is a good person. He has an impossible job, but no one makes him stay in it. And the fact that he doesn't have a red line that is on the other side of being undermined by the president or called fat by his colleagues, or, I don't know where his line is, but they've crossed a lot of lines that I wouldn't have stayed there for.
Yeah. It is fascinating to watch every day. And the crazy thing is, 2 months from now, the lines you're talking about will also feel quaint, I feel like.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, we have a director of the FBI, and even the FBI director used to sort of be an untouchable job. You didn't attack the FBI director. And we now have a president who called him a crazy loon with a bunch of Russians who taunts him on Twitter the way, I don't know if you have kids, but kids taunting people on Twitter.
Kids taunt me.
Grown-ups taunt me, but you can't treat people on Twitter the way the president treats former officials in his government without getting kicked out of most private and public schools. He's a cyberbully. So just all the conduct is so unprecedented.
Well, I hope you'll come back and we can talk about it more. It's great to have you in the building.
The show. Thank you so much.
And welcome to the building. Nicolle Wallace, everybody.